this message simple faith may claim. Yesterday, today, forever, Jesus is the same. Still he loves to save the sinful, heal the sick and lame. Cheers the morn that stills the tempest, glory to his name.
Glory to his name. Glory to
not a blast of hurry, touch the Spirit there. Stay upon Jehovah, hearts are fully blessed, finding as He promised, perfect peace and rest. Every joy or trial falleth from above, traced upon our dial by the Son of Love. We may trust Him fully, all for us to do. They who trust Him wholly find Him wholly true. Stay upon Jehovah, hearts are fully blessed, finding as He promised, perfect peace and rest.
Amen.
To Him who on Jesus His Son will believe, hallelujah, 'tis done.
Jonah this afternoon, as we have been looking at some things in Jonah chapter 1, the book of Jonah chapter 1. Jonah chapter 1, I'm going to be reading verse just 15, 16, and 17. And I'm going to be taking a look this afternoon at Jesus' thoughts on the book of Jonah. So that's what we're going to be looking at. Jonah chapter 1, and the start there at verse 15. Would you honor God's word, stand as we read his preserved, inspired word of God that we have in our hands. It's just a wonderful thing for us here. Jonah chapter 1, start at verse 15. So they took up Jonah and cast him forth into the sea, and the sea ceased from her raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly and offered a sacrifice unto the Lord and made vows. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Father, I come to you this afternoon. I thank you for your blessings, and what a good morning service we've had. Amen. Lord, all the children, not just from the Rodriguez family, but the other children behaved so well today, and we thank you for that. And Lord, there's times when I think about another building to meet in, but then I'd hate to have the children out of the service. What a blessing to have the little ones, that they might hear the Word of God the way we all do. So thank you, Lord, for what you've blessed, and thank you for this book, and thank you for the importance of the book that we've opened up, and I pray that you'd bless, that we'd all have something spiritual and something that we'd understand even more about the book of Jonah today. And so I need your Holy Spirit anointing once again, for I know it's not me, it's not none of my thoughts, none of the things about me, but it's only what your word put into our hearts in such a way that the Spirit of God in us can use. And so we look to you for love and blessings and help in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I cannot state strong enough this afternoon about the importance of the book of Jonah. And yet, this book seems small and maybe insignificant, and we've heard the account of it. We know the story of Jonah, and many, many people know about Jonah and that kind of thing. But it is a very, very important book. And what's interesting is that critics of the book do a lot of damage to our salvation, our thoughts on salvation, when they tear apart the book of Jonah. You know, when they say things like, well, you know, Jonah couldn't possibly have gotten swallowed by a whale, that kind of thing, you know, by a fish, that wouldn't work. You know, that hurts, and I'll look into that some. Also, they'll say things about Jonah. Well, this is just a wonderful book, but it's all pretend, you know, and a nice story to have, and, you know, kind of gives us that thought about God. And, well, let's focus in on the fact that God's merciful and, you know, spared the city of Nineveh. And that's true, you know, that's in there. But the real importance is where we're coming to here at verse 17, then all of chapter 2. And this is the real significant part of it. And we need to understand that. This has got to be taken seriously through here. You know, some other ways that they attack it is to say, well, this is the equivalent of, you know, Hercules and the sea monster in all of mythology. And it's interesting, and I know I've told you folks this before, but, you know, my daughter did a study she actually taught the class at Carnegie Mellon on literature and mythology and that kind of thing. And there is a thought within literature, within the, you know, academia of the study of English and stories and all that kind of thing, that the Bible is actually the source of all of the stories, all of the mythology and all that kind of thing. And that's one of the theories. Of course, there's an opposite theory to that, is that all of those mythology things all then came to the Jews and became the Bible. Well, we know that God inspired this, and this is, you know, the facts that we have before us. And it's really not right for us to say these are stories, because stories are made up.
Right.
You know, these are accounts, you know, of what happened. And this is an account here. Mm-hmm. Some others say that Jonah was rescued by a ship. that had as its masthead a fish head, kind of a thing, as the figurehead. You know, ships, you know, would have, they'd have a mermaid or naked woman or something for their masthead, and that it was a fish that picked him up. Some others think that Jonah floated on the carcass of a dead fish until he floated to shore, you know. And but that's not what God's word says.
That's right. Yeah.
It says here, and we read it in chapter 1, so they took up Jonah, cast him forth into the sea. And then verse 17 tells us, now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah. Uh-huh. And that's exactly what happened. One gulp, he's down the hatch, and he's gone. Mm-hmm. And no wonder the men feared. Amen. Mm-hmm. I mean, they saw that it calmed the sea immediately. Mm-hmm. You know, I can't imagine that Jonah stayed down for very long before he came back up. And when he came back up, it was calm. Threw him in, the sea is raging. Wind is blowing. Water's coming into their ship. Throw him in, and as he goes under, it all goes calm. And when he comes up, it's glass surface. That's how I picture it. Yeah, I mean, just incredible. No wonder they feared the Lord. Amen? Mm-hmm. They feared the Lord. But we have to understand, thus saith the Lord about all of these things, and any of the other kinds of ideas about Jonah and what happened to him and that undermines the truth of Jesus Christ being crucified until he was dead and then buried for 3 days and rising again.
Yep.
Any other thing than what this scripture has before us undermines that. So I'd like us to take a look at the thoughts that Jesus had on the book of Jonah, and we're going to turn to the book of Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12, and we're going to see some things here, and this is all familiar to you, I know it is, but I just want to bring it out before we go into chapter 2 of Jonah. But Matthew chapter 12, verse 38 through 40 is all I'm going to read. Matthew chapter 12, verse 38 through verse 40. Then certain of the scribes and of the Pharisees answered, saying, Master, we would see a sign from thee. And you have to remember that they were always after Jesus to, you know, to catch him off guard, or as in this case, well, we want you to be the performer. Okay? You know? There's something going around on Facebook that is coming up, and it's a quote from Spurgeon. And it says something like this, you know, either it'll be preachers preaching to the saints, or it's going to be an entertainer, you know, tickling the ears of how's it go, Devin? Something about the clowns or something like that. You know, it's going to be clowns with the entertainment. And, you know, that's what they wanted from Jesus. Entertain us. Give us a sign, you know. You know, make something appear out of your sleeve or something. You know, that's what they're saying. So, verse 39, but he answered and said unto them, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. And there shall no sign be given to it, but the sign of the prophet Jonas. For as Jonas was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. That's what he said here. And, of course, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. You know, there's a lot of people that like to go to church, and they only go there and they want to see some spectacular thing happen. You know, they want to see somebody come in a wheelchair and somebody, you know, do this hocus-pocus thing with them, and they get up and walk, and they think, boy, that was a great, great day. You know, God said, I'm not in the wind. I'm not in the thunder and lightning. I'm in that still, small voice.
Amen.
And sometimes just one part of a verse of Scripture will be what your heart needs.
Mm-hmm.
Now, but an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. Well, I went to church and nothing happened. Must not be a very good church. Mm-hmm. Think I'll go to another church where something's happening. Yeah, that's the generation we live in. Yeah, that's a shame. that we have that. So he talks here about this, the fact that there shall no sign be given to it, but the sign of the prophet Jonas. For as Jonas was 3 days, 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. I'm going to take a look at a little bit here, if you would. Go with me to Numbers chapter 16 and verse 32. Back to the book of Numbers chapter 16, verse 32. And in the book of Numbers chapter 16, we have Korah and the followers of him. Dathan and Abiram, they rose up against Moses. And something happened new here. Verse 30 of chapter 16 of Numbers tells us, but if the Lord make a new thing, and the earth open her mouth and swallow them up. And so verse 32, the one that I asked you to turn to, says, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up, and their houses, and all the men that appertaineth unto Korah, and all their goods. And I ask you, as you read that verse of Scripture, do you think that Korah and all of them set up house inside of that new part, inside of the earth, you know, where God opened up the earth's mouth, and they set up house and they had just a wonderful time there and that kind of thing, and 3 days later, whatever, they came back out? No, I don't think so. Mm-hmm. You know, they went into the center of the earth that way, they were swallowed up, they were dead. Mm-hmm. Right? They're dead. Now I'm going to ask you to go to Psalm 16, if you would, please. Come on over to the book of Psalms, Psalm 16. I'm going through the Psalms right now as I read through the entire Bible again. And in Psalm 16, if you take a look here, David, of course, is the author. And in verse 9, we read this. Therefore my heart is glad, and my glory rejoiceth. My flesh also shall rest in hope. For thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. Thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. So verse 9 and verse number 10 there are talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. You know, thou shalt not leave my soul in hell. Yeah? Jesus is telling us here in Matthew chapter 12 that just like Jonas, you know, like Jonah was in the belly of the whale, was in hell. He was dead. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's not just floating around on a carcass. He's not been rescued by some ship. He's dead. And we have to keep that in mind. Look with me, if you would, in the book of Acts, chapter 2, and verse number 31. All the way to the book of Acts, chapter 2, and verse number 31, please. And here we read in the book of Acts, chapter 2, verse 31. You know, Peter's giving this sermon, and he says this. He, seeing this before, spake of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither his flesh did see corruption. And he's speaking about earlier that's he quoted from the Psalm 16, up there in verse 25 down through verse 28. He quoted where we looked at before. And this whole idea of the resurrection of Jesus Christ comes all around that account of Jonah. So here's four of the thoughts of Jesus, if you will. Here's the first one. Jesus believed Jonah to be a real man. Amen. Jesus believed Jonah to be a real man. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're talking flesh and blood here. We're talking feelings and will. We're talking fears and desires. When he quotes the prophet Jonah, he's talking about this man that shows up in the book. He's also in the book of 1 Kings, and we're not going to take a look there. We've already done that. But, you know, Jonah was a prophet, and he was a real man, flesh and blood, just like we are. And what we see in the account of Jonah in his book is that he had feelings and emotions and all that kind of thing, and he knew the what was going on in the times and all of that. Yeah. Can you imagine any one of us getting called to be a missionary to the Hezbollah? God says, I want you to go. I want you to go over to, and he'll point to a country, or say to Egypt, and I want you to talk to the head of the Muslim Brotherhood. That's who I want you to go to. Say, no way, eh? No way, Lord. This boy is not going to do that. He's going to go to Alaska. You know, that for me would be the farthest away from, that'd be the worst place for me to go. But, that's for Jonah. Can you picture yourself being called by God and said, here's where I want you to go? Well, that's what he was. He had his feelings and fears and all that kind of thing. And he was called by God to be a prophet. You notice that Jesus here said the sign of the prophet called him a prophet. God called him to do that. He was anointed for service. That's what Jesus says about this man, Jonah. He's a real man, a real prophet called of God. Even though when we look at the book of Jonah, we say, man, this guy wasn't a very good prophet. He didn't want to go. Then when he went through and did preach to him, then he was just sitting there hoping that God would destroy them anyhow. I mean, what kind of prophet is that? God called me to Ithaca, and I'm going to sit there on the side of the hill and say, Lord God, I just can't wait for you to just send fire and brimstone down on all these people and all end up in hell. This is going to be great. I can't wait to see it. You think, wow, if that really was how I felt, it'd be no wonder nobody comes to Christ here. Amen? We have a burden for them. I can't imagine them burning in hell. I look at those people, I see them all over, and I think, phew. I'm here, Jeannie and I are sitting, we're waiting to get on an airplane headed back to Ithaca, and I think, most of those people are going to end up right in Ithaca. I'm sure there's some that drive in, but they're going to end up in Ithaca. They're going to burn in, if the plane goes down, Jeannie and I are all right, but what about the rest of these people going to burn in hell? Phew. Yeah. So we think, but Jesus called him a prophet. He was used of God. God worked through him. Even though there were times his heart wasn't right, God can use you sometimes when your heart isn't right. Amen? Mm-hmm. Just make sure your heart's right. But here's the second thing that Jesus believed and had thoughts about Jonas. The second one is that Jesus accepted this book as factual information. Did you catch that? Jesus accepted this book to be factual information. When Jesus said there's no sign given but the sign of the prophet of Jonah, for Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, he was saying that this is factual. This is exactly what it was. It's not a myth. It's not some tribal story that's been passed down. This actually happened. This is the real thing.
Amen.
It's what Jesus is saying here. This actually happened. He's saying this because it's useful. They knew what happened both in Jewish history and in the history of Nineveh. So the Jews are looking at it, and they're seeing here, we've got it recorded for us, and we've had it written down about this prophet, and, there were people that had lived when Jonah was around. Amen? Mm-hmm. And when Jonah got done at Nineveh, do you think that he just kind of hung out there, or do you think maybe he wandered back to where the rest of the Jews were, and told his story over and over again? I have a tendency to think he got his heart right. That's what I have a tendency to think, and who knows how God used him after that, but that's what I think. And then they get conquered by Assyria, they get conquered by Babylon, and in this whole thing is the history of these people, the Gentiles, the heathen that are conquering the Jews, and they've got recorded that this man came through. We all repented and put sackcloth and ashes from the king on down. Even made the animals do it. It's in their history. So for people to say it's a myth, you know, it's something made up, no, and that's not what Jesus thought was about it. Now, he knew that it was history. Here's the third thing. Jesus taught that the great fish he had prepared was indeed a whale. Jesus taught that the great fish he had prepared. You notice I put that in there. That he had prepared was indeed a whale. Verse 40 here in Matthew says, for as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly. That's what he says. Matthew 12, verse 40. In the whale's belly. Now, remember, Jesus as God is the creator, and he's the one who prepared the fish. In Jonah chapter 1, it said, now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. And Jesus tells us that that fish was a whale. Of course, what we get into is the zoologists don't want us to believe that whales are fish, that they're mammals, and therefore they're in our league, and so we have to, you know, give them all the rights that they give to us. Whales swim in the water like all the fish do. You know, bears will wade in the water, but they don't live in the water. Bears are mammals. Humans are mammals. You know, isn't it funny? Ducks have, you know, a whole lot of their life in the water, but they're not considered to be fish or mammals. I wonder how they get all these things goofed up. You know, God knows what he made. Amen?
Right.
Jesus, the creator, prepared that fish. Can you imagine? Here's Jesus in heaven as God, because he's always been God. And here's Jonah. He's gone. All right. There's the whole, you know, waves, the whole storm, the whole thing. He's down sleeping in the hold of the ship and that kind of thing. And then Jesus there. I'm going to prepare this whale because it's going to be a picture of the tomb that I'm going to when I die on the cross for mankind's sin. And I'm going to be in it 3 days and three nights. Mm-hmm. Here it is. He prepares that way. Now, it's true that whales do have mammalian characteristics. Mm-hmm. By that I mean their young are born live, and then their young suckle. They have whale's milk. I actually have run tests on whale's milk when I worked at Dairy One. Yeah, okay, but they're not mammals. They are fish. God's word says fish and whale, puts them together, equalizes them. That's what God says. I'm going to stick on God's side.
Amen.
Amen. Let all the scientists laugh at me. That's fine. But in the end, guess who's going to be right? God is. Amen. You know, God's going to set all those scientists straight. Amen. But let's go on here and look at a fourth thought that Jesus had about Jonah. Jesus said that Jonah was a picture of his own death, burial, and resurrection. It's obvious, but I'd have to state it for us because I want to develop it a little bit here. Jesus said that Jonah was a picture of his own death, burial, and resurrection. You can be sure that the people of the day that Jesus lived in understood that Jonah died when that whale swallowed him. I have to break this to you. I know it's going to be a tough one for you all to understand, but they did not have Disney's movie Pinocchio back then. Isn't that a terrible thing? I know that disperses a lot of bubbles for you and all that kind of thing. But we've got that picture, you know, of Geppetto down inside the belly of the whale. And he's got a little house set up. I mean, you know, his fish is still in the little bowl, you know, in the fish bowl. And he's got a table there, candle on it. And, you know, he's got plenty to eat. You know, I mean, every once in a while, a fish goes by and he can grab it, and he's got something to eat, and seaweed for, you know, his greens and all that kind of thing, you know. And there goes Pinocchio, you know, the little wooden boy underwater. I mean, isn't that amazing? You know, it takes a lot of faith to believe all that stuff, but there goes Pinocchio and gets into the whale and finds Geppetto and starts the fire, and the whale belches him out again. Everybody alive. Geppetto, Pinocchio, little Chloe, isn't that the fish's name? I can't remember the cat's name. The cat was Figaro. In there. What's that?
Figaro.
Figaro was the cat. Yes, thank you. The little cat, everybody. Everybody's alive, right? No. Jonah was dead, died. Mm-hmm. His body and soul were separated in that and that's what Jesus is picturing. The people then understood that Jonah had died and yet was resurrected by God. That's what they understood in that day. That's why Jesus could just say this and not explain it. Mm-hmm. You see, if they had questions about it, Jesus would have told them what actually happened. Mm-hmm. But he said, just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Just exactly the same way that you all know that Jonah died when he went into that belly. See, Jesus could point to it as a prediction of his own death and burial and resurrection. You see, they want to make us think that Jesus didn't rise from the dead. Because if He didn't rise from the dead, he's not God who he says he is. If Jesus didn't rise from the dead, you and I have no hope of resurrection. We either are going to just go into the ground, go back to earth, dust to dust, and that sort of thing, or the reality of what the whole Hindu religion and all those kind of people think, well, we're going to come back as, you know. I hope I don't come back as a skunk. Nobody likes skunks, you know. Well, there's a few people that have them as pets, but, you know, it wouldn't be my luck to get one of them. Yeah. If I were going to come back, I'd want to be a nice, cute, cuddly little dog. Wouldn't that be? But I don't want to be that either. I want to be in heaven with my Savior. Amen? That's where I want to be. And when I die, that's what's going to happen. But Jesus was adamant here about the fact that this was a picture of his death, burial, and resurrection. And if it isn't, we're in trouble. We're in trouble. So when we come back to the book of Jonah here, and chapter 1, verse 17, now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and it swallowed him up. And just like anything else a fish eats, it dies. That's what happened to Jonah. In verse 17 of chapter 1 of Jonah says, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Not much hope in that case. Just like Lazarus, he was in the tomb so long that, you know, they said, Lord, he stinketh. Mm. Can you read somewhere in the white around that verse 17, Lord, he stinketh. Yeah, he's dead and rotting already. 3 days inside with that belly of that fish with all those enzymes and that kind of thing going on, digestion going on. He's dead. He's dead. So what I want us to walk out the door with understanding is that anyone who denies the accuracy of the book of Jonah is denying the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. If we don't if we don't grasp a hold of Jonah the way it is before us, that Jonah was thrown overboard and that fish prepared by God swallowed him up and he died. And we're gonna come to that when we come to chapter 2, verse 2, where it said, "And he said, and I cried by reason of mine affliction unto the Lord, and he heard me. Out of the belly of hell cried I, and thou heardest my voice." And he's dead. He's a dead man. If we have to understand that we'd be at odds with Jesus himself if we took any other kind of position on the book of Jonah. Mm-hmm. That it's about a real man. It's an accurate account of this real man. And that fish, that whale, literally swallowed him up. It's not some myth, not riding on a dead fish. I thought when I heard that, when I read that one, I thought, wow, that's a wild one. You know, I suppose I'd hang on to, I've been to the ocean a lot of times and I've seen them some great big dead fish. Man, they stink. That's bad. Maybe for my life I'd hang on to one, but I don't know. I think I'd learn to swim. You know, I could tread water a lot better. I don't know. But, he really, really was inside of that fish, you know, dead inside of there. And that he also was resurrected, mm-hmm. just like Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I don't want to be at odds with the Lord Jesus. Mm-hmm. That's for sure. And when you talk to people, you know, story of Jonah and the whale, common enough. But you can always take it, show them Jonah and the whale, and then bring them here, Jesus Christ. Use that to picture that he was going to die on that cross when he shed his blood. He was going to be buried 3 days, 3 nights, and then rise again. Mm-hmm. Let's pray together. Father, as we come to you, we thank you and praise you for this small, just four-chapter book. It's all it is. And it's an account that's been written down that many, many people have heard, though they may not have heard it and understood it the right way, but they've heard about Jonah being swallowed by the fish, spit out again, and going to be the prophet God had wanted him to be. And I pray that you would just help us to understand it's an important book. It's not just a little children's story. It's an incredible picture of what Jesus Christ did for us. And we'll always thank you. Lord, we've had a good day. Thank you for meeting with us. Thank you for blessing us. Thank you for just the good camaraderie we have within our church family and just the blessing. I'm thankful, Lord, to be back with my people. And Lord, it's nice to be away. I was in some hostile territory, Lord. And so it's so good to come back to people that have a love for you and have a love for each other. And what a blessing. Please, just help my church family. Thank you for all you are and all you do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen, dear ones. Lord bless you all.